Hello?
Oh, no.
Yeah. I don't know.
I feel like I'm talking into a tin can, but that's okay. I'll try that again. I just a few announcements before Dennis comes up and shares a couple of things for you. First of all, we are having a Christmas Eve service in person. It will be here on Saturday evening, obviously Christmas Eve at 7 o'clock. And we certainly encourage you to come and invite whoever you would like to come. There's some pretty amazing music involved, and we're just looking forward to that experience of being back together again. Speaking of which, after the service, surely it means she said three or four strong people. Not men. She said strong men, but I'm going to say strong people to help her bring up some benches upstairs to help get candles all organized for Christmas Eve. So if you're strong, like Boo, she will see you downstairs, right? And she will be appreciate your help. There is a service on Christmas Day. It's at 11 o'clock, so our usual time. So if you aren't busy, doing the eating turkey or something, you can come and be a part of that. And also on New Year's Day, there will also be a service in our usual 11 o'clock. Just a couple of pastoral updates. First, the happy one. Martin got a text from Clasford. He's home. He's home in Jamaica, and he's so happy to be home. He wanted to send his greetings to everyone to thank them for their support. I am sorry to tell you that Rick Bates, that's Carolyn Anderson's father, did pass away. Was it yesterday or the day? Yesterday. So our condolences to that family, and also a request for prayer for them going through this difficult time. I'm going to ask Nancy now to come, and she's got a couple of announcements.
Good morning. One announcement about Christmas Eve. We've had a tradition more recently of taking up a Christmas Eve offering and giving it, not taking that offering for ourselves as a church, but donating it to someone else or another group. So this year we're going to split it two ways. It's going to go towards the Caring Cupboard, our food bank, our local food bank, as well as Riverside, as they are going to be up and running in January. So that's where the offering is going to come. And if you're not able to be here on Christmas Eve, you can still donate and raise the office. The other thing is more, just to let you know as a congregation, that we are going to be having a warming center housed out of this church. So you might remember that last year we piloted, it was a number of individuals, it wasn't a particular group that piloted a warming center here for about 2 months. And Church of Serving put in a proposal to our county, and we were granted funds to run for Church of Serving to run a warming center, which will be here. Church of Serving has hired, which I'm on the board for, has hired a program manager. We'll be hiring two trained staff as well. And I just feel so blessed that we have a church that has a spot that we can welcome people into this place. So we don't need money. What I'm asking for is prayer. Prayer, we're hoping to be open by January 1st. And we need to hire two staff people. So I'm asking for prayer that those people, those trained people, would come forward, be interested in this job. Just praying for the people that are coming in, for the staff, and that we'll be able to open hoped on January 1st.
Thank you, Nancy. Let us begin our time of worship with prayer, and let us pray. Gracious Creator, you bring the world forth from your hand. Make your presence known to us today, that your children may drink deeply from the abundance of your glory. May we be newly born. May we grow to give light to those who dwell in the darkest of nights and who sit in the valley of the shadow of death.
Let us be called to worship responsibly. In Advent, we look for a sign of God's presence among us.
But the only sign God gives us is the sign of Emmanuel.
The prophet spoke of a young woman who would bear a child by that name.
And the angel told Joseph that Mary's child would save the people from their sin.
We thank God for the sign of Emmanuel. Lead us to its resting place, that we too might find God with us. Let's stand together for our first Christmas carol, Angels from Around the World.
Thank you.
Isaiah chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. The word that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and say, "Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths." For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord.
Let us join together for our litany. Our God is among us, be not afraid.
Whatever I may be shattered, God comforts us today.
Our God is among us, be not afraid.
Our families may quarrel, our friends may forsake us.
Our God is among us, be not afraid.
O child of God, come among us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter within. Be born in our lives today. The world's dark streets are burning, a great and holy place. The hopes and fears of all the years are met and renewed today.
The stage is now set for us to have Christ present his gift of life to us. We have been granted the grace to have been invited to participate in the grand drama of changing lives for the glory of God. As we offer our tithes and offerings this morning, let us step boldly onto the world stage and offer to God what we bring in anticipation of the power our gifts have to transform lives. Let us pray together. Gracious Lord, you have certainly been generous to us. We pray, Father, that we too might have that spirit of generosity within us, to not only offer our gifts today, but to offer ourselves to those that we meet, wherever we may go. Help us to express your love in a generous way. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to invite the Duthie family up. And as they... Did I do something funny? Oh.
You're good, Darrell.
Okay. That was scary. Maybe I said their name wrong. They're going to come to light the wreath. In the meantime, all the other children, if they want to come up and sit in that front pew, that would be good. That's basically what he wanted. And a couple little ones over here. Okay. All right. I will get out of your way.
Let this Let us pray. God of our salvation and author of our hope, it's hard for us to see the blessings you have for us. We think that our plans are better, that the things and desires of the world are higher than yours. You, Lord, are the great interrupter, and sometimes we can feel inconvenienced by the calls you put on us to seek justice, love, mercy, and walk humbly with you. Remind us that this season that leads to Christmas wouldn't be here at all if it weren't for you loving this world that you made. Thank you for loving us, God. Amen.
So, before we do our children's story, we're going to sing our song. And we're ready for that. So, thank you, you two over there. And I'm going crackly again. So, I was thinking about music because it's, what time of year is it again? Halloween? Yeah. And I'm back over here.
Doing the same thing.
It's me. I must be giving off all kinds of vibes. Are you sure it's Christmas? It's not like Canada Day or something like that? No, it's Christmas. Wow, can't pull the wool over your eyes, can we? Never. Okay, you're right, it's Christmas time. Now, one of the things about Christmas is, what happens, like, what do we like about Christmas?
Everything.
Really? Okay. It's God's birthday, and you like it because of that. That's good. Anything else? Do you like the presents or no? You really don't? You don't? Mom and Dad, you're good. You don't have to worry about that. Of course, you like the presents. One of the things, though, that I like about Christmas time, and I'm sure you do, is the music. Do you like the music at Christmas time? We just sang the Advent song there. We sang some other songs this morning, and we've been singing other songs. So I wondered, out of curiosity,
What is your favorite Christmas song?
Yes.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I kind of expected to hear that one this morning. Same. The Light of Christmas. That's one I'm not 100% familiar with, but maybe I have because I heard it, but I can't remember. Yes, dear. You don't know?
No.
Levi, do you have a favorite Christmas song? No. No. Shall we see what the adults have? Who wants to offer their favorite Christmas song? Oh, way over here.
Joy to the world.
Come next Sunday, or you're away. Next Sunday, I'm actually going to talk about that. Yes? Heart the Herald Angels Sing. That was last Sunday we talked about that.
Silent Night.
Silent Night is Christmas Eve. We're going to talk about that one. Sorry?
What child is this?
I'm not talking about that one. Yes.
Away in the Manger.
Away in the Manger. Good one.
O come,
Emmanuel. By the way, Martin, that is probably the oldest Christmas carol we sing. It's very old. It's been around for a long time. Anybody else?
Bethlehem.
Little Town of Bethlehem? Yeah. Good. Nobody said anything about that donkey song? I had to look that up, by the way. It's on your radio station. I've never heard it before. So I looked it up. Is it Dominic? I don't know. Who cares? I don't know. Anyway, what I'd like to do today is to thank God for the music of this season, because it is so wonderful. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you that this Christmas season means that we have so much music to enjoy. Music that celebrates the gift of your Son, and music that just celebrates the season of being together and all the fun that goes with it. Father, help us to sing with our whole selves through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our New Testament lesson today is taken from Paul's letter to the Colossians,
chapter 2, verses 8 to 15. Colossians 2, 8 to 15. See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the universe, and not according to Christ. For in him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily, and you have come to fullness in him, who is the head of every ruler and authority. In him also you were circumcised with a spiritual circumcision, by putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ. When you were buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through faith in the power of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with him when he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record that stood against us with its legal demands. He set this aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and made a public example of them, triumphing over them in it. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. We've been having this journey of looking at some of the Christmas carols that we sing, and maybe some of the message or the theology that's communicated in those. Today was an interesting one. God rest ye merry gentlemen. I start with a little story. Grandpa walked into the family room and found his little grandson, Jeffy, standing up in the playpen, crying. He looked so pitiful, standing there in a little baseball t-shirt and his diaper. His face was red and tears streaming from crying. When Jeffy saw his grandpa, his face lit up in a way that, well, it just smote the old man's heart. He immediately reached up his chubby little hands in supplication. Out, Papa, out. What grandpa could resist such a plea? Not this one. He walked over to the playpen, reached down to lift up his little buddy out of captivity and distress. Just then, however, law and order stepped into the room. Jeffy's mother walked out of the kitchen with a dish towel in her hand and spoke sternly. No, Jeffy, you are being punished. You have to stay in bed. Leave him right there, Dad. Oh, fine. Now what's a grandpa to do? His grandson's tears and reaching little hand just tugged mightily at his grandfather's heart. But he didn't want to interfere with his mother's discipline either. He couldn't stand staying in the same room with the little boy, reading his newspaper or pretending to not care. Nor could he turn around and walk out the door without feeling like a betrayer to his little pal. What could he do? Love finds a way for him. Well, since Grandpa couldn't take Jeffy out of the playpen, Grandpa climbed in with him. If you're in the playpen, buddy, I'm in the playpen. What's your sentence? How long are you in for? And finding a big, jolly grandpa suddenly filling his little prison cell, the little boy found comfort even in his captivity. Comfort in captivity. I think that's a pretty apt description of the Christmas carol that we just sang. God rest ye merry gentlemen is one of the most famous and most theologically rich Christmas carols that's in existence. For 500 years, these classic lyrics and catchy tune of this song have just enhanced our Christmas celebrations. Now, I am fully aware that this particular Christmas carol has fallen out of favor of late due to what seems like very much an inclusiveness in the song. And some people have tried to get around the fact that it says gentlemen by saying or singing something like this, God rest ye merry gentle people. That still sounds awkward, doesn't it? At least to me. Here are the lyrics again. God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we have gone astray. O tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. O tidings of comfort and joy. In Bethlehem in Israel, the blessed babe was born and laid within a manger upon this blessed morn, the which, to which his mother Mary did nothing take in scorn. O tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. O tidings of comfort and joy. And yes, there is a third. Now, I wish I could tell you today that there's a grand backstory to this well-known carol, but I can't. Scholars have been working for a long time to try and determine where this Christmas carol came from, although it's clearly an English carol. Of all the carols still being sung today, this, as I mentioned, is one of the oldest. It dates back to the 16th century, of all things. And believe it or not, Charles Dickens even mentioned this song in his classic 1843 story, A Christmas Carol. The theme of the carol is somewhat challenging to our modern sensibilities. We're told in the first verse that Christ was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power. That's a very potent theological thought for churches to consider in this season. Despite our misgivings, though, the carol does have biblical support for its ideas. The Bible says it like this: the reason the Son of Man appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. That's 1 John 3, verse 8. All through the New Testament, when we read about the life of Jesus, he's always wrecking the power of the devil. Every time he resisted temptation, every time he healed an illness, every time he cast out a demon, generally, Jesus made a mockery of the devil's plans. Of course, the ultimate example of this came where? At the cross, where he devastated the devil's plans once and for all and gave us life, life eternal. Colossians 2, which I read for you, and you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us in its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. The problem with this wonderful gift of God through Jesus is that as free from darkness as we are, many of us still live like we're completely unaware of that freedom. I read a little story about way back when President Abraham Lincoln was bringing in the Emancipation Proclamation. He signed that proclamation in September 22nd, 1862. In the moment it went into effect on January 1st, 1963, every slave that lived in the Confederacy was now legally free. But until they knew of their freedom, the legal fact had no impact on their lives. In fact, it's recorded that Union soldiers carried hundreds of thousands of copies of that proclamation and passed them out as they made their way south during the war, so the slaves would know. God rest ye merry gentlemen is a reminder. It's a declaration of our emancipation. The carol tells us to remember. Remember our freedom. Remember the heavy cost to obtain that freedom. You know, we cherish the Nativity story. But we should never forget where that story led. The story of Christmas does not end on December 25th. Instead, where does it lead? It leads ultimately to Calvary. And that's the point of this old Christmas carol. Christ has set us free from power. We must recognize that fact. We have to live like it's true. C.S. Lewis is probably best known as the author of the Chronicles of Narnia, that series of children's books that has been made into at least a couple of movies. But Lewis wrote many other books, including a very special one entitled Mere Christianity. In that book, he tries to explain and defend the belief that has been common to nearly every Christian in all times. He writes, the central Christian belief is that Christ's death and also his coming to life again has somehow put us right with God and given us a fresh start. This is what Lewis writes. We believe the death of Christ is just the point in history at which something absolutely unimaginable from outside shows through to our world. You may ask, what good will it be to us if we do not understand it? But that is easily answered. A man can eat his dinner without understanding exactly how that food nourishes him. A man can accept what Christ has done without knowing how it works. His death has washed away our sins, and in dying, he's disabled death forever. Christ's work of salvation is cause for rejoicing no matter who we are. The carol, though, is calling us to remain focused on what the gift of Jesus has actually accomplished. Freedom. The challenge that the carol points at is that though we are free, we prefer not to live like we are free, or we remain still under the power of whatever it is that's enslaving us. Do we really believe we're free? Our reluctance to believe that we are free is why so many people gravitate to what's called a works theology. It means that we think in our minds that we have to earn our way to our deliverance. If only I did the right thing or sacrificed enough or said the right things, then I can earn my freedom. But it's ridiculous when you really think about it. How in the world do you earn something you already have? Imagine driving into the local car dealership with your car. It's all paid for, but then you offer the car dealership money to buy it. Who does that? And yet we continue to think that we have to earn God's favor. Where is the comfort and joy in that? We have an awful time grasping the full significance of grace, you and I. When we question the nature of the gift, though, we're insulting the giver. By refusing to accept the gift, we are in many ways refusing to accept the one who's giving us the gift. We cast suspicions on the giver. What do they want? What are they trying to earn from me? Sometimes we're embarrassed by a gift because we've got nothing to give in return. So our minds immediately try to think of a way to pay that generosity back. And then there is the very worst thing we can say when someone gives us a gift. Oh, you shouldn't have. When we refuse to live like we're free in Jesus, it's kind of like saying to him, oh, you shouldn't have. Is that the message we want God to receive from our lives, to receive from our hearts? Is this what we think of the nativity gift and ultimately the gift that ends at Calvary? Are we with our lives saying to God, oh, you shouldn't have? You know, the Bible is full of wonderful images of grace in action. And the one that really captures my heart is found in 2 Samuel 2. And you can look it up and read the whole story. And there we read a scene transpiring in the palace of King David. Gold, and you can picture gold and bronze statues just gleam around the room. Lofty high ceilings crown the spacious room of the palace. It's the banquet room. And King David and his children have gathered for the evening meal. There's Absalom, David's son, tanned and handsome. There's Tamar, his beautiful daughter. The call to dinner has sounded. The king scans the room to make sure everyone's there. But one figure is absent. Then everyone hears the sound. Clump, scrape, clump, scrape. The sound is coming down one of the hallways that leads to the dining room. The sound echoes throughout the room as everyone just waits. And finally, a person appears at the door and slowly shuffles to his seat. It's Mephibosheth, who was crippled as a baby while his nanny fled the palace after Jonathan, his father, died. David wanted to honor his beloved friend by showing grace to the sole survivor of Saul and Jonathan's line. It is only when his whole family, including Mephibosheth, is finally seated that the feast can begin. Julie Martin was reflecting on this beautiful story, composed a very enlightening poem. It really touched me. It's entitled Grace in a Barren Place. This is what she wrote. I was Mephibosheth, crippled by my twisted pride, and hiding from you in a barren place where you could not find me, where you could not give me what I deserved. But somehow you found me, and I don't understand why, but you give me what I do not deserve. You not only spared my desolate life, but you made it bountiful. And here at your table, I will thank you, my King. You see, we're all Mephibosheth. We're all crippled by our pride. We're all unwilling to humble ourselves and simply receive the gift of grace that is offered to us. Humility is the key here. Have you ever noticed that when your hands are full of things, you cannot receive anything, let alone a gift? To receive a gift, any gift, we have to let go of whatever it is that we're carrying in our arms that's a burden, to embrace what is being offered to us. We have to let it go. Let go of the hurts and shame, the brokenness of our lives, and let us just receive the grace. In his book, In the Grip of Grace, Max Lucado writes this. In my first church, we had more than our fair share of Southern ladies who loved to cook. I fit in well because I was a single guy at the time and I loved to eat. Our potlucks were major events. I counted on those potlucks for my survival. While others were planning to cook, I was studying my bare kitchen shelves to see what I could offer. And the result was pitiful. One of my better offerings was an unopened sack of potato chips. Another time I took a half-empty jar of peanuts. It wasn't much, but no one ever complained. Those ladies would take my jar of peanuts and set it on the long table with the rest of the food and then hand me a plate. Go ahead. Don't be bashful. Fill up your plate. And I would. Mashed potatoes and gravy, roast beef and fried chicken. I came like a pauper and I ate like a king. The Apostle Paul would have loved that symbolism. He would say that Christ did this for us, letting us come as paupers and making us royalty. As the carol states, there is nothing to dismay or make us distraught. His victory has been won. You're free. There's no point trying to deny it. There's no point trying to earn it. You are free. No ifs, ands, and buts. You are free. So why do we still cling to what enslaves us? Why is the darkness so attractive to us? Can I simply suggest that it is because we don't truly believe the power of what Christ has done and continues to do. I've said many, many times to you over the years that all theology is transformative. If you really believe something, it will make a difference in your life. That goes especially for what this particular Christmas carol is talking about. Let nothing to dismay. As the Apostle Paul insisted in Romans 8, and I firmly believe with every ounce of my being, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor power, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Do you believe that? If so, you can rest. You can be at peace. And this, my friends, is truly tidings of comfort and joy. Let us pray together. Oh God, your story of salvation is marvelous. Who would have thought that you would come to us in person, let alone come to us as a baby, born in very humble circumstances? Who would know that you would grow up the son of a carpenter? That you would gather together a band of disciples and walk around the area of Nazareth and Galilee and Judea, sharing the good news, telling stories that bring us life, and loving all who came to you? Who would have thought that ultimately you would go to the cross at Calvary? You would suffer humiliation and be crucified. Who would have thought that in 3 days' time, after that horrible death, you will also rise from the dead and defeat the powers of darkness once and for all? That's the message, O God. That's our hope. That is what gives us peace. So, Father, help us to believe. Help us to truly believe in the power of your grace. Help us to stop trying to earn what is already given to us. Help us to know each and every day that we are free. Free from the bondage of sin. Free from the control of darkness. Help us to be free to live abundantly. Father, this morning, in our hearts and minds, we're deeply concerned about those that we know and love. We think, Father, this morning about the Bates family as they grieve the loss of Rick. Comfort them, Father, as only you can comfort. We are grateful, O God, that you are providing the resources needed to provide a shelter from out of the cold. A shelter that's so desperately needed in our community. We pray, O God, that the staff will be hired quickly and that you will give opportunity to open that shelter, to give people a place to be warm and safe. And Father, we thank you for all the things that are going on in your name in this community. Help us to be encouraging, help us to be supportive, and help us in our own way to show your love to all that we meet. And now, Father, we just offer ourselves to you as you offered yourself to us. We thank you through Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. I did forget one little announcement, and that is that following the service out this doorway here, there are refreshments provided for us, and we hope that you'll stay and have some fellowship with one another. Oh, and yes, don't forget Shirley's request for 4 strong people downstairs to help her get that stuff up. Our concluding hymn this morning is Light of the World. Please stand as we stand.
Thank you.
As an anxious mother and father await a tiny child's birth, so God yearns for us. And as the tired child cries for the parent away from home, so we yearn for God. May God's arms embrace you until you find your peace. May God's shoulder carry you until you find your rest, that you may shoulder those burdens that have never been touched and embrace the hearts that have never been held. Amen.